I have been having random songs pop into my head from when I was young. And my neighbor Steve said it should not be a surprise that the songs that stick in our heads are from the years when the hormones began to flood our bloodstream. So I've been hearing Beatles songs lately, and they bring me back to how I used to think about things. Those were simpler times. The tune in my head this week was one of Paul McCartney's off of Sgt. Pepper. I've got to admit, it's getting better. It's getting better all the time. Yes, I admit, it's getting better. It's getting better since you've been mine. Of course, it's almost a silly little love song about how staying in a relationship makes life better. But it also works in broader strokes to summarize how I thought of things in those days. Yes, everything is getting better all the time. People are learning more. They are better educated. People will make a bit more money this year. Science will answer all our questions and solve all our problems. That's what I thought until I was about 10 or 12. By the time I was 13, I was wondering why there was still a war in Vietnam. And that war went on for another 5 years. And even though segregation was now declared illegal, racism seemed to get worse. I could not understand it because I was brought up to believe that progress is inevitable. But then I read somewhere, hang on a second, you might want to check in with the Jewish community on that one. Jewish culture has a deep sense of history going back 3,000 years. They know their own history well, and they know everyone else's because it connects to theirs. They're very historically literate. And they will tell you, some decades are better than others. One year you're in the Promised Land, and 100 years later you're slaves in Egypt. One year you regain your freedom and rebuild the temple. 100 years later, the temple is destroyed and you are in exile. One year you have successful communities throughout Europe. Then 100 years later, you have discrimination, pogroms in Russia, and a Holocaust perpetrated by your spiritual cousins, the Christians. Sometimes the truth is an ugly truth. The Jewish community is wise knowing how ugly the truth can be. The rest of us sometimes believe that ignorance is bliss. Dr. King admired the Jewish culture. Black people make a mistake, he said, if they, quote, nurture a persistent myth that the Jews of America attained social mobility and status solely because they had money. It is unwise to ignore this error. In a negative sense, it encourages anti-Semitism and overestimates money as a value. In a positive sense, the full truth reveals a useful lesson. Jews progress because they possess a tradition of education. The Jewish family enthroned education and made sacrifices to get it. End quote. King says, look to this and follow. Look at the strength of knowledge that comes out of the Hebrew Bible that we read every week. This was largely passed over in my Christian education. I heard Old Testament stories like Noah's Ark and the Garden of Eden, but why did we not read Proverbs and sit with them and think about them and discuss them? That's what we do in Bible study every week, by the way, and we have for 6 years now. Listen to this small snippet from today's reading and let's unpack it. My child, do not let these pieces of wisdom escape from your sight. Keep sound wisdom and prudence, and they will be life for your soul, an adornment for your neck. I guess being smart makes you good looking. Then you will walk on your way securely and your foot will not stumble. If you sit down, you will not be afraid to sit down. When you lie down, your sleep will be sweet. Your sleep will not be tormented with worry and anxiety. Sounds nice, doesn't it? Then you will not be afraid of sudden panic. You will be ready for bad news. Or the storm that strikes the wicked. For the Lord will be your confidence and will keep your foot from being caught. This one's a good one, 27. Do not withhold good from those to whom it is due, when it is in your power to do it. God, I wish I listened to that. My auntie died in her sleep on Friday, and I owed her a visit. I withheld good from her when it was in my power to do something. That kind of wisdom can hurt. It can be hard won. And I hope I can bring this to bear before it happens again, because it will. Do not withhold good from those to whom it is due, when it is in your power to do it. There is a movement in parts of this country to ban books that tell uncomfortable truths, especially teen LGBTQ literature. Also things that make white males like Glenn Beck feel bad. That's a quote from him. They want to ban American history books that tell the story of what we did to enslaved people and indigenous people, or what Jim Crow laws are, how it started in the North and still lives in our laws. Because we want to think America is perfect, and we don't want to face the truth if the truth hurts. We are squeamish and a baby-like nation sometimes. But we need to develop a way of thinking that isn't all black and white. We need to perceive the idea of paradox, that there are two things that can be true and opposite at the same time. We need thicker skin mentally. Again, Anne Lamott, the Presbyterian writer, told us that all truth is paradox. The earth is a beautiful, amazing place that has seashores and earthquakes and plagues and joy and disease, Mozart and babies and sunsets and acne. It's both and, it's all of the above. The United States is an amazing country based on an idea that the government is there to protect our freedoms, not take them away. It has brought forms of liberation to countries all over the world. It has also made its first batch of wealth by taking lands from the Indians, who were decimated by European smallpox, by stealing the rich half of Mexico, by enslaving millions of Africans, and creating the greatest inequality of income in the history of the world. It's both and, it's all of the above. It's not just America that carries paradox. When we look at the Holocaust, we have to remember that Hitler had a lot of help. We think of France as being the good guys in that war, but only 4% of the population was involved in the resistance until shortly before the invasion at Omaha Beach. When the Germans got to Paris in 1940, the French pulled the army out and said, "Come on in, it's an open city." And they lived together in luxury for 3 years. Coco Chanel or Chanel No. 5 shacked up in the Ritz Hotel with an SS officer for 4 years. Then the Germans said, "Okay, we want you to take the French Jews out of Paris." And the French police said, "Sure." And they rounded up 50,000 Parisian Jews and shipped them off. With almost no help from the Nazis. 3% came back. France had a Jewish premier, and many Vichy French folks preferred Hitler. So Paris is a beautiful city with an ugly price paid for its preservation. Quite the paradox. It's very human. A few weeks before Dr. King was assassinated, he went to the 60th birthday party for his dear friend, Rabbi Abraham Heschel, professor of Jewish ethics and mysticism at the Jewish Theological Seminary in New York City. It was a memorable occasion. They went to a lodge in the Catskills, and 1,000 rabbis stood and sang, "We Shall Overcome," in Hebrew. I love that image. Early pictures of Dr. King marching in Selma show a short rabbi with a yarmulke, a skull cap, next to him. I was 8, and I was fascinated. We didn't see rabbis walking with the Lutherans, let alone a Black Baptist. Rabbi Heschel was asked in 1965 why he left the safe confines of New York City to take part in a march for voting rights in Alabama. Heschel said, "When I march in Selma, my feet are praying." Most Jews in the United States would identify with the Black liberation struggle, a struggle that includes the civil rights movement, but it's much more than that. It's well known that Jewish financial support for the NAACP was crucial to getting it started and keeping it alive. And remember, the 3 civil rights workers who were murdered in Mississippi in the voting rights campaign of 1964. One worker, James Cheney, was a local Black man. The other 2 were Jewish guys who came in from the North. Jerry Goodman was on his first day on the job. And Mickey Schwerner was an atheist Jew and one of the main organizers. What's an atheist Jew doing registering Black voters in Mississippi in 1964? The KKK called him Goatee. They hated him. But things have not always been smooth between the Black community and the Jewish community. Areas that have been called Black ghettos were originally Jewish ghettos. It's true in Minneapolis. And when the Jewish people could afford to move, they often rented that space to Black people who resented their prosperity and accused them of taking money out of the community. Jewish people would say, "We opened stores in those neighborhoods because we couldn't get jobs anywhere else. People wouldn't hire Jews. So we had to start our own businesses." The Black Muslims also have been very harsh on Jewish communities because most Jews are white. So their shared history has both bright and shiny illumination and cold, harsh shadows. It's a paradoxical relationship. I'm bringing this up because of the general climate of anger and hate right now, especially fostered by Fox News, which often will introduce a story by saying, "This story will make you really mad." There's a little video clip of like 15 stories starting with that line. "This story will make you really mad." That's what they're selling, is anger. In that climate, anti-Semitism is on the rise again. You'd think we learned something, but if we know we are people who ignore or forget history, it should not surprise us. Sometimes we start to backslide. PBS tells us this. The Anti-Defamation League, which tracks anti-Semitic behavior worldwide, found 2,717 incidents in the United States in 2021. That's a 34% rise from the year before. It averages out to more than 7 anti-Semitic incidents per day. My Jewish friends are in a state of tension all the time. And anti-Semitism bleeds easily into other forms of hate. It becomes everyday racism against Black people, Asian people, Native Americans, and the LGBTQ. But then it can become a new form of hate, approaching the edge of genocide. From the New Republic magazine, Florida Governor Ron DeSantis signed a horrifying bill Wednesday that will let the state take transgender minors away from their families if they are receiving gender-affirming care. The new law will allow the state to take custody of a child if they have been subjected to gender-affirming care, which includes puberty blockers and hormone replacement therapy. Florida courts could modify custody agreements from different states if the minor is likely to receive gender-affirming care in that second state. The text refers to gender-affirming care as sex reassignment prescriptions or procedures, and qualifies this care as a form of physical harm, end quote. In other words, not only can the state interfere with what a doctor and a woman decide about a woman's health care, the state can now kidnap your child if they don't like the decisions you make with your doctors and your children about the care that they give the kids. Freedom? You're losing it by the yard. America's paradox, a lot of freedom, except when there's no freedom at all. A national party that was founded on expanding freedom is now chopping away at the most personal forms of freedom that we have, personal health care, and how you raise your child. It hurts to admit this, but wisdom is hard won. Sometimes the little crucifixions we have to face are in acknowledging the truth about our country, and it can be very painful. On the other hand, we see in Chaska what happens when realistic people acknowledge the problems that are really here and make something happen to change the course of local history. It's in this week's paper. This week, Jenna Cruz, who presented here a couple weeks ago from Moms Demand Action, she went in front of the city council and got them to add Chaska to the list of cities who are acknowledging the truth about America and are deciding to push back. Here's the quote. This is from Jenna. "What a night. I presented to the Chaska City Council and asked the city to sign a proclamation making the first Friday in June National Gun Violence Awareness Day, and to light up Fireman's Park in orange June 2nd and 3rd in honor of Wear Orange, and also to post on social media to raise awareness." And they said yes to all of it. We also talked about decreasing gun violence and crime through environmental design. Thank you, Chaska City Council. That's our Jenna. We can be proud of Jenna and the Moms Demand Action team, which I would like to make into one of this church's missions. It helps me understand that while there are people in the community who resist change and steal flags, we also have a city council that will listen and can do the right thing sometimes. We have seen that in the school board elections and in the efforts to fight racism through war, residents organized against racism, and the Indivisible group that tees up on issues that need our attention further down the timeline. For me, there is the final irony of historical fact that cements Dr. King into an eternal bond with the Jewish story. His last speech is called the Mountaintop Speech. You can watch it on YouTube. It makes me cry every time. In the Hebrew Bible, God does not allow Moses to go to the Promised Land, but Moses is allowed to look at it from the mountaintop. Dr. King's speech in Memphis concludes with the warning. "Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I have been to the mountaintop. I have seen the Promised Land. Like anybody, I would like to live a long time. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I have looked over, and I've seen the Promised Land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that as a people, we will get to the Promised Land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. So we as a people are embedded in the struggle of the Jewish people to find refuge here, to be free of fear. We owe them for the bedrock of our faith. And we as a people are embedded in the struggle of the Black Americans to find freedom from fear and a home for justice. And if we believe in liberation as the central theme of the story of Moses, which is what our faith is about, freedom from fear, freedom from hate, freedom from sin, freedom from harming others, we are embedded in the struggle of the LGBTQIA people, especially trans people and their families who are under attack, mocked by so-called progressive authors, comedians, and cultural figures, while Florida wants to separate children from their families. Their struggle is our struggle. This is not a faith of escapism. Let us pray. Dear God, some weeks are better than others. Sometimes the bad news comes by the bucket. But you give us the strength and the tools to carry on. And we will walk on our way securely, and our foot will not stumble. We will not be afraid of sudden panic, nor of the storm that strikes the wicked. We will not be afraid. And when we lie down, our sleep will be sweet. All this we ask in your name. Amen. Thank you.